Time, so far, we have been discussing things from time and frequency domain, and we always assume that our time domain signal is continuous. So we have been focusing mostly on continuous time signals. Tamam? Now the issue is, in practical life, when you go to the field, whether you work in electrical, computer engineering, or even any other discipline, reality of life right now is that everything which is continuous is being converted into discrete so that you can use computers, controllers, whatever, in the digital domain, and then you can produce the output again in continuous domain, okay? So there is a big need actually to be able to deal with things that are discretized. But before doing that, we need to know how to convert a signal from a continuous representation to a discrete representation, or we call, yeah, so from continuous time representation to discrete time representation. And the reason I mention time is that you can also do things in the dimension of the amplitude of the signal. We will see that either towards today's lecture or next lecture, depending on how well it goes, okay? So first thing, let's start by looking at, first of all, if I have a continuous time signal. So let's say, for example, again, the topic today is about sampling. And the idea of sampling is converting a signal from continuous time representation to discrete time representation. So basically, instead of the signal looking like this, right, this is a continuous time signal, okay, I'm looking for representing the signal this way, right, so samples only that exists at discrete times, right? Okay, so these red ones are the samples, so this is discrete time representation. Okay, and the other black one is the continuous time representation, right? Okay, now the question is, or not the question, the important note to keep in mind that as far as we are concerned, we are dealing with sampling where the distance between one sample and the other is always constant, and we call it the sampling time. Okay. And this kind of sampling is called uniform sampling, because you are taking samples from the signal at uniform distances, always TS between one sample and the next sample. Okay. There is another more advanced version, which we are not going to study in this course. It's not even in the book. It's in some advanced books of signal processing, which is non-uniform sampling. And it has its own advantages, but it's a little bit more complicated mathematically to deal with. So that's why we do not address it now. Okay. Now, if the signal is uniformly sampled, and I move from the sampling, from the discrete representation, to the continuous representation, right? So in that case, I deal with something called reconstruction. Okay, or sometimes it's called interpolation. Okay, so the other option or the other thing is reconstruction. Okay, sometimes it's called interpolation. Typically in math, they call it interpolation, but in signal processing, we call it reconstruction, which is basically converting a signal from discrete time representation to continuous time representation. Okay? And the movement from continuous to discrete, while maintaining the information such that you can move again from discrete to continuous without losses, so you can reconstruct the original signal, requires certain conditions. We will discuss them in a minute, okay? So performing sampling while maintaining all continuous signal information such that you can reconstruct the original continuous time signal, okay, has certain conditions. Okay, I'm not going to discuss these conditions now, but just keep in mind that if you perform sampling the wrong way, if you do not obey these conditions, then reconstructing the original signal becomes impossible. You cannot reconstruct or becomes extremely difficult. Okay? You cannot reconstruct the original signal because you will lose some information of the original signal. And we'll discuss this in a few minutes. Okay? So now let's, in order to be able to figure out these conditions, let's look how we perform sampling, right? And then see how the signal is represented in time domain and frequency domain. And let's see what's the option available for us to reconstruct the original signal. And based on the way of reconstruction and the representation of the sampled signal, we will be able to figure out this condition or these conditions that allows us to reconstruct the signal successfully if we obey them while doing the sampling. Okay? Let's start by sampling. As we mentioned, or as we looked at in the previous page, right, we had a continuous signal, and then we picked some samples from that signal, and we marked those with the red color, right? If you look at this, like, and mathematically, the representation that we did, which looks like this, right? Okay, so we have the continuous signal, and then we are picking samples. The way to pick those samples such that they still have a correct mathematical representation is actually by multiplying the signal by delta functions, unit delta functions, at the locations, right, which are distant TS from one another, right? Okay. So simply, I end up with this, right? The sampled version of the signal is actually delta, right, at different locations, at the locations of the samples, multiplied by the function. Remember that when you multiply a delta by a function, the result is going to be a delta multiplied by the amplitude of the function at that particular point, right? So basically, if this is my x of t, the continuous time signal, right, and I multiply it by a delta, let's say here at, this is a delta of at t minus, okay, 2TS, right? Where TS is my sampling time. So I moved 1TS, I moved 2TS, right? Then this delta is multiplied by X at 2TS, right? The amplitude of the delta here is simply, because that's a unit delta, and then when it's multiplied by the function, it simply gets the delta multiplied by an amplitude which is equal to the amplitude of the function at that location. That was a property of the delta that we studied earlier. This is without integration. It's just multiplication. خلاص? So that's the value of the delta at that location. If you want to write the whole train of deltas that you have there, then you simply can say that the sampled signal, we call it x bar, right, of t, is equal to the summation from n equals minus infinity to infinity to cover the whole time domain, right, of x of t, my continuous time signal, multiplied by the delta at t minus n ts, right? And as you change the value of n, you end up with t minus ts, t minus 2 ts, t minus 3 ts, and so on, right? These are deltas, one after the other, right? So these are those deltas, right? This delta, this delta, this delta, and so on, right? If you add them together, you will end up with a train of deltas with amplitudes that are the values of the signal at those locations, right? It's clear to everyone? Fine. Now you can rewrite this, or you can further write this as the summation from n equals minus infinity to infinity. And instead of saying x of t, take the actual value. The actual value is going to be x at nts, right? Multiplied by delta of t minus nts, right? Okay. So that's basically how the sampled signal looks like. Okay, so this is my sampled signal. This is the discretized signal already in time domain. Okay. Now, if I tell you that the continuous time signal, this guy, somehow when I do its Fourier transform, it ends up being something like this. So let's say that the Fourier transform of this ends up being something like this. Okay. Yeah, just I'm assuming. Okay. So the shape of the function is such that its frequency domain representation looks like this, with a bandwidth B here and minus B. B in hertz, so it becomes 2 pi B in omega, right? And minus 2 pi B, right, in omega. So this is my x of omega, the Fourier transform of my continuous time signal. Okay? What do you think the Fourier transform of the sampled signal would look like? How can you figure it out?
It would be deltas.
No. Look at the representation here and try to convert this into frequency domain. Now.
2 points and zeros, 1 point in the middle.
No, it will not be a line. Anyone has a guess? How can you find the Fourier transform? Look at this one. Don't look at the down one. Look at this one. How can you find the Fourier transform of this?
It's a
line. It's a constant.
Delta, the Fourier transform of
the
delta is constant, and then it's multiplied with scaled by x of nt. No?
This is not a delta by itself.
Uh-huh.
This is a train of delta.
Ah, okay.
Right?
Okay. Yeah, right? It would be a train of delta.
Yes, like, exactly. So basically, I can rewrite this. Okay, so look at this one. X bar. I can rewrite it as x of t outside, right, multiplied by summation from n equals minus infinity to infinity, delta of t minus nt, right? And there is nothing wrong with this. It's exactly the same, right? Now, if I take the Fourier transform of each one of those separately, what will I end up with? This is a signal that I know that its Fourier is going to be x of omega, this one, right? And the train of delta, what was the Fourier transform of that? Yeah, what was the expression, the exact expression? I know it's a train of delta. Bring it up from your notes or whatever. Omega s multiplied by, so the other one, this one by itself, is omega s, the sampling frequency, multiplied by the summation from n equals minus infinity to infinity, and it becomes delta of omega minus n omega s, right? And then, instead of having multiplication in time, we end up with what in frequency?
Convolution.
But the convolution is multiplied by 1 over 2 pi. Yeah. So 1 over 2 pi, the Fourier of the first multiplied by the Fourier of the second, right? This is multiplication in time, results in convolution in frequency, and in that case, the convolution is multiplied by 1 over 2 pi. Hello? What's going to be the result of all of this?
That follows the trend of the original.
Trend?
It's gonna look like x of omega, but in discrete.
This is convolution.
No.
When you convolve each x of omega with a shifted delta, what do you get? You have x of omega.
Delta omega.
Take the x of omega inside the summation. There is no problem in doing that, right? So you end up with x of omega convolved with delta of omega minus n omega s, right? So you'll end up with x of omega minus omega s, x of omega minus 2 omega s, x of omega, right? So you'll end up with this expression will become, now we can do some cancellations here. So omega s divided by 2 pi becomes ts, the sampling time, right? Okay, where just to say here omega s is equal to 2 pi over ts, just by definition, okay? So this becomes ts, and then we have summation x of omega convolved with delta of omega minus n omega s, right? Now this convolution produces what? And the summation from n equals minus infinity to infinity. So when you convolve a signal with a shifted delta, what do you get? The signal shifted, right? So it becomes x of omega minus n omega s, right? And it's multiplied by ts, and this is from n equals minus infinity to infinity. So take n equals 1, so take n equals 0, you will end up with this guy, right? We did 1 over ts, yeah. Okay? So you'll end up with the same signal, right? No shift, nothing, right? And then when you take n equals 1, you'll end up with the signal shifted around omega s, right? So the same shape shifted around omega s, right? And then the same shape shifted around 2 omega s. And then from the negative, similarly, right? For n negative. So minus omega s minus 2 omega s, and so on. And it continues the same way, right? And each one of those, instead of being, if we said that this is of amplitude 1, each one of those is going to be of amplitude 1 over ts, right? So the signal x of omega shifted, whether it's around 0, around omega s, around 2 omega s, and each one of those is multiplied by 1 over ts, so the amplitude becomes scaled to 1 over ts. But the signal shape is the same. It's only replicated. Now,
how 1 over 2y became 1 over ts?
Now?
1 over 2y. Keeps that 1 over
2. Fin 1 over 2 pi. 1 over 2 pi madrub of omega s. Okay? So 1 over 2 pi, وفي omega s هنا. So omega s over 2 pi becomes 1 over ts. Hello? Any other questions? So this is how the signal sampled will look like in frequency domain. If I ask you, how can you recover the original signal, what would you tell me? What should you do from a frequency? This is the original, this is what you have from the sample. So what should you do?
Filter.
I want to recover the original, so filter, take this one and scale it by ts, right? So basically, the reconstruction is going to be simply by taking this guy only, right, by itself, right, and then multiply it by ts, right? So simply, the reconstruction is going to be by a low-pass filter that has a width equal to double the bandwidth of the signal, because it has to take both the positive and the negative side, but it has to make sure it rejects everything else, right? So it just needs to surround the one here, right? And then take that out, scale it back, and then when you convert that, when you look at that from time domain, it will become the original continuous signal, right? Because from frequency domain, this would look like this, correct? So this is basically the reconstruction. Okay? It's done by low pass filter with, okay, amplitude ts and frequency bandwidth equal to 4 pi b, right? Because this one, only each one of those is 2 pi b, so the width of both is 4 pi b. If you look at the full width, if you want to look at bandwidth from only like one side, then it's 2 pi b. خلاص? Okay? That's the bandwidth of your reconstruction filter. The question is, okay, what's the condition for sampling such that you can do this reconstruction? Who can tell me? Now, we did sampling. When we did the sampling, we produced the red signal, right? And then we saw that from this red signal, we can easily reconstruct the original by taking only the triangle around the zero, right? The original signal around the zero, and then rejecting all the other replicas of the signal. What would have happened wrong in the sampling that would cause this not to be possible? And that will tell us what's the condition on correct sampling. What's the parameter here? What's the only parameter that we can control in the sampling, by the way? When we did the sampling, what
TS.
Was TS. So what could go wrong with TS such that I cannot do this reconstruction?
Different.
What would
happen?
What would happen if this second replica triangle, right? If this guy is close until it interferes with this one. Don't forget that. Those are added together, right? We end up with the expression here saying the summations of those replicas. As long as they are separate, when you add them, they will be one after the other. If they become overlapping, what would happen when you add them? The shape will change, right? So if the sampling was very, that results in very close replicas, then it would have been something like this. This is what we don't want, okay? So if we violated the rule, and we will see in a minute what's going to be the rule, then the replicas would have been, okay, let me just draw them in kind of, right, this, and then the next replica probably would have interfered somehow, right?
Yes.
And then the next replica also would have interfered somehow. And then when you do the summation, you will end up with something that looks like, for example, in this case, probably you will have some constant, right? If they were with the same slope, right? Or you will have, if they were not that much overlapping, then you might have ended up with something that looks like this, right? And then line, and then this, and then line, and then this, and so on, right? Important thing is the shape that you will end up with is mixing up, and you cannot, using a low-pass filter, you cannot recover the original signal because you don't have a separate replica of the original signal, right? They became overlapping, and when you added them together, they became inseparable, right? And you cannot control it. The addition is going to happen by the sampling operation, right? So this summation is happening anyways. It's just how we saw the signal in frequency domain. It's not how we controlled it, right? It's how it looks like. So the only thing that you can do is to make sure that the replicas are far from each other so that when they add up, they don't overlap. They become totally separate. So eventually you can take one of them by the reconstruction operation and recover the original signal. Tamam? So the condition is going to be what? That this point must be greater than this point, right? If you guarantee that, then you guarantee that they will not overlap. What's the value of this point? Omega S minus 2 pi B, right? Correct? Because we said that the width here is 2 pi B. So this point becomes omega S minus 2 pi B. And this point, the end of the first one, is 2 pi b. So the condition is that this must be greater than this. So the condition must be omega s minus 2 pi b must be greater than 2 pi b, such that the next replica does not overlap, and this will guarantee that all the coming replicas will not overlap, right? Okay? So the condition is going to be omega s is greater than 4 pi B. And we call this the sampling theorem. So the sampling theorem says, okay, sampling theorem. Okay, says that if you sample a signal at a frequency, okay, strictly larger than double the bandwidth, okay, then you can fully and uniquely reconstruct original. Continuous time signal using an ideal low-pass filter, as we saw in the previous example, right? And the condition says that omega s is strictly larger than 4 pi b. Again, if you write this in frequency rather than in radian frequency, right? So this becomes fs is greater than 2b, right? So you have to sample at a frequency greater than double the bandwidth. If you calculate that in hertz, if you calculate that in radians per second, then it becomes omega s greater than 4 pi b, since the bandwidth in radians is 2 pi b. Okay, so it's the same thing. Okay, why strictly larger? Even though if we looked at the previous situation, we would notice that even if they only touch at one point, I can still recover by the low-pass filter. Because if you look particularly at signals that are composed of single frequency, such as a cosine, and then you sample the cosine strictly at double the frequency of the cosine, you will have multiple interpretations of the recovery. Because you will end up, if you do that, you will end up with samples that are all equal, right? When you look at them on those samples, they could be samples from a constant signal, they could be samples from a cosine function, they could be sampled from double the cosine function, right? So there are many, right? So there are many ways that you can do it in that case, okay? So the only way to make sure that it's uniquely recoverable is to be greater. You cannot be equal for special cases. For most of the cases, you can be equal, but this is too theoretical. That double bandwidth, this frequency, which is the minimum sampling frequency, is called the Nyquist frequency. Okay, so whenever you are told, for example, that a signal is sampled at the Nyquist frequency, this means that it is sampled at 2b, double its bandwidth, or in radians, 4 pi b. So this is called the Nyquist frequency, which is the minimum sampling frequency for reconstruction. Okay, one other important thing, that effect that we have looked at, okay, the effect when you sample at omega s smaller than Nyquist, okay, we looked at that overlap that happens between the replica, and you cannot recover the original signal. The effect when you do that is called aliasing effect. Okay, so whenever you hear about aliasing, it means that one way or the other, you ended up sampling less than the Nyquist, and the result of that is that the sampled signal is going to have the replicas overlapping each other, so that when you look at it in frequency domain, it will no longer look like the original signal, and you cannot recover the original signal. So that's the effect of aliasing, which is basically the effect that happens when you sample at a frequency smaller than the Nyquist frequency. This is called aliasing effect. Okay, I'm going to stop here because I still have some stuff to discuss, but I want you first to absorb these things before going to the reconstruction and then some practical issues with the sampling field. So next time we will discuss the reconstruction operation itself in more details. How do you reconstruct the signal, whether you do it ideally or maybe you can use some approximations. And then we'll look at some practical issues of the sampling as well as the quantization. Just a small piece about quantization.